Y'all fit in here too. Amazing. I'll tell you what. I've been doing what I've been asking you folks to do. I've been talking to my friends, my family, my neighbors, total strangers, so my voice is a little hoarse. I don't have quite as strong a voice as the Lieutenant Governor just did, so I'm going to calm you down just a little bit before the real rock star comes on stage. But listen, this is about talking to as many people as possible because we all know exactly what is at stake in this election. The financial future of this country, the America that we know and love, is at issue. And let's face it, President Obama, he takes a look at America like it's a pie. And all he's concerned about is let's slice up that pie so it's fair. Now, we all know when you take that approach, what's gonna happen is that pie is gonna shrink and everybody's gonna get a smaller slice, right? Our approach, Governor Romney's approach, hopefully President Romney, Vice President Paul Ryan's approach is gonna be let's grow that pie. Let's make sure everybody's share is larger. Now, in the home stretch here now, let me arm you with just a couple little pieces of information you can use to talk to those people that are sitting on the fence. First of all, we need leadership. You know, this is a land of abundance. It's a land of bounty. It should be a land of unlimited opportunity. The missing ingredient is leadership. And that is what we have been missing now for the last 4 years in Washington. President Obama doesn't have a clue how to lead. He came in his first 2 years, he totally controlled government, veto-proof Senate. And what did he do? He sat down with Republicans, he said, sorry boys, we won, we're gonna do things our way. It's our way or the highway. Not a very good way to lead. Which then, when the American people repudiated his programs with November 2010, when Wisconsin turned this blue state into red because President Obama scared us, he has been totally unable to lead this nation. So understand the stark difference between Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan. Men who have a proven track record of reaching across the aisle, working with the other side to actually govern. Mitt Romney did it in Massachusetts with a Democratic legislator, 87% Democrat. He took a $3 billion budget deficit, turned it into a rainy day fund. And of course, we all know how respected Paul Ryan is in Washington. His Medicare proposal is what? It's a bipartisan proposal with liberal Democrat Senator Ron Wyden. That is a demonstrated ability to lead. It's what President Obama simply is unable to do. So when you're talking to these people who may be sitting on the fence, just pose a question to them. We're gonna have, the House is gonna be Republican. I am begging you, please, elect Tommy Thompson as an ally to me. You wake up on November 7th saying, my junior senator is who? My junior senator must be Tommy Thompson. That's up to you. Here's something else you got to tell your friends that may be sitting on the fence. We as Republicans, as conservatives, we are concerned about every American. We want every American to have the opportunity to build a good life for themselves and their family. Mitt Romney is certainly a man like that. And Paul Ryan, in answering that 47% question in his debate, had the perfect answer. He told a story. He told a story of how Governor Romney demonstrated extraordinary generosity and humanity in dealing with that family who had a tragic accident with their two sons. The story I've been telling, because as a business person, it resonates with me, is the day when one of Mitt Romney's partners from Bain Capital came into the office and told Governor Romney about his 14-year-old daughter who had been missing for a number of days. She took an unauthorized train trip from Boston to New York and he hadn't seen her. Now, as an employer, I've dealt with those situations in the past. But the first reaction is, boy, take whatever time you have, take it off, family comes first. Had I really been feeling generous, I might have even offered to pay for a private eye to help locate that girl. You know what Governor Romney did? He did far more. He did something extraordinary. He shut down Maine Capitol. He shut it down. He took his 30 employees, took them to New York City, established command center, printed 300,000 brochures. They found that girl. They saved her life. We have the opportunity on November 6th to elect that type of extraordinary leadership. Folks, I honestly believe people like Tommy Thompson, people like Paul Ryan, a man like Mitt Romney, these men were created for this moment in time. They were created to save this country. You were created to save this country. Now I'm talking about the country. You know what's interesting? The first time I ever heard about Marco Rubio is I heard he's this up-and-comer from Florida that won a primary against somebody who I believe is now a Democrat. But because I was thinking about doing the same thing, I never heard Marco Rubio speak. And so I started my campaign, and I started talking to people like you. I started talking to people like you about how much I love this country. How much certainly I understood that in the span of human history, this 236-year-old experiment we call America, how exceptional it was. And how I stepped up the plate because I was panicked for our country. I thought we might be losing it. I came in at a perspective as a third or fourth generation immigrant. I mean, we are a land of immigrants. But I came at it from a perspective of somebody who has understood the private sector. This free market competitive system we have that is a marvel, that has lifted more people out of poverty in the history of mankind than any other system. So again, like you, I recognize from that perspective that this is a land of bounty, of abundance, a land of unlimited opportunity. But later on I found out that Marco Rubio had the same message but from a different perspective. As a son of first generation immigrants that came to this country and understood its unlimited potential. And so Marco Rubio, in the end, won a very important Senate seat in Florida. Because he understands how precious this nation is. And so, let's face it, Wisconsin, we've been pretty blessed with rock stars. Paul Ryan, Scott Walker, Ryan Supremus. It is my honor and privilege, and by the way, I'm really happy that Marco's here today because it must mean he's pretty satisfied with what's happening in Florida. Yeah! So he's here today because he recognizes, by the way, that the financial future of this country, the America we know, may come right down to the state of Wisconsin, to the county of Waukesha, to the city of Waukesha, to the people that you get out to the polls. So it is my honor and privilege to welcome a rock star in the Republican Party to Wisconsin, Senator Marco Rubio.
Wisconsin. You know how you say Waukesha in Spanish? Waukesha. Anyway, thank you guys for having me here today. I'm so honored. Can I just brag for a moment on your Senator Ron Johnson? One of the first guys I got to know when I got elected, proud to support him in some of his endeavors. He's a real up-and-coming leader in our conference, in the Republican conference. But here's what I love about him. People spend a lot of time in Washington talking about business, including people in our own party, and they mean well, and they have the right principles on it. But I love when the conversation turns to principles to principles of business and how decisions are made by businesses. And Ron Johnson's in the room, and he speaks up and says, excuse me, I know a little bit about business because I lived in that world. We made those decisions. We had to make payroll. He is a leader because he understands what it takes to grow America's economy. Putting in the water here, or maybe in the milk. But you've done a pretty good job of sending him some pretty good leaders in the last few years. We've got a Republican National Committee chairman from here that I went to law school with. He actually studied. At the University of Miami, he actually studied. You've got a great senator, Ron Johnson. You've got a governor and a lieutenant governor that's been in the news a little bit. You may have heard about them. And then, as if that wasn't enough, you sent us the next vice president of the United States, Paul Ryan. Gallons of water, milk, and some cheese, and take it back to Florida and around the country, and see if we can't create some for ourselves as well. But listen, I'm so grateful to be with you here today, and all of you are doing. I just want us to take a moment. This is not a group I think I have to convince to vote for Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan. But what I want to convince you of is how important it is, everything that you're doing. Every single one of us, whether it's at home in Florida, where by the way we're going to win. Probably a handful of Packer fans here, but you're playing the Jacksonville Jaguars. We're both swing states. Take it easy. Don't run up the score if you get ahead. We need both Florida and Wisconsin, so. But I want you just for a moment to understand, we all know somebody. We all know somebody that isn't going to go vote unless we take them. Every single one of us knows someone that cares about the future, but they're busy. Stuff's going on. And if you don't get them to go vote, they're not going to go. And that's what we're down to right now. That's what we're here to rally and remind ourselves of. How important it is to get to vote, and the earlier the better. Because the earlier we can vote, the earlier we can get our friends and our family to vote, the more time we have to find other people to get out and vote. And here's what's at stake. This is not just a competition between Mitt Romney and Barack Obama. This is a competition about the future of our country and what kind of country we're going to have. Ron Johnson just talked about that briefly. To really understand what's at stake here, we have to remind ourselves of who we have been. Do you realize that there's about 6,000 years of written human history, more or less, for the fact checkers at home? Almost everyone that's ever lived has been poor. Almost everyone that's ever lived has been powerless. Almost every person that has ever lived in the history of the world has been poor and powerless. Unable to do any better than their parents did. Whatever your parents did for a living, whatever your grandparents did for a living, that's what you were stuck doing. That has been the human condition for almost all of human history. That started changing a couple hundred years ago, when on this continent, some extraordinary people wrote down on a document called the Declaration of Independence, the heartfelt principle. The true principles that say that every single person that has ever lived, every single person on the planet, is born with certain rights that are given to them, not by their government, not by their leaders, not by their king, their president, or even by their constitution. These are rights that are given to you by your creator. This It delineates the main ones, life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. But at its core, what that means is that every single person has the right to have an opportunity to go as far as their talent and their work will take them. To make of their lives the most that they can without any artificial barriers. Now that's wonderful written on a piece of paper, but then you have to live it. And we have. And the reason why we have lived it so successfully is not just because of our political freedoms, but because of our economic ones. Because of a system of free enterprise that says, if you have a good idea and you're willing to work hard, you're going to have a chance here, and it doesn't matter where you start. It doesn't matter that you are a worker, you can be an owner. It doesn't matter that you're an employee, you can be an employer. It doesn't matter that your parents were poor and disadvantaged, you should have the right to have a chance to go as far as your talent will take you. For people like me and so many of you that have been born and raised in this country, who have lived here our entire life, this is all we've ever known. It's easy to take that for granted. We can't. America is the exception, not the rule. The freedoms that we have, the opportunities that we've had economically, this is not the way most people have lived, or even the way most people live now. And so what we are fighting for in every generation is not just to maintain that, but to build on it. To perfect it even more, and to hand it down to the next generation of Americans. And that's what's at stake in this election. Because I'm not saying they don't love America, and I'm not saying they don't want America to be exceptional. I'm saying to you that our opponents in this election have ideas that have never worked anywhere they have ever been tried. That they have ideas for government that have failed everywhere they've ever been attempted. Their ideas are the ideas of countries that people come here to get away from. They try to tell people that if you're struggling, if you're hurting, if you're trying to make it, that big government is the way forward. But here's the truth. Here's the truth. One of the great lies, one of the great myths that some try to spread in American politics is that big government helps the people who are trying to make it. That isn't true. In the words of a well-spoken vice president, Mr. Joe Biden, these are the ideas that bury the middle class. Big government doesn't help people who are trying to make it. I don't want to pick on him for a moment, but apparently, the vice president was somewhere yesterday. I think, if I'm not mistaken, he was in Iowa bragging about how much they were spending in Wisconsin, or he was somewhere and he mixed up the states. So Ohio, and talking about Iowa. So it's great to be here with you today in Virginia, because, anyway, this idea that big government helps people that are trying to make it is not true. Let me tell you the truth. The truth is that the big companies, the big corporations, the multi-billionaires, they probably don't like big government, but they can afford to deal with big government. They can hire the best lawyers in America to find the loopholes to the taxes and to the regulations. And if that doesn't work, they can hire the best lobbyists in Washington to create them. They can use the power that they have and the access to power that they have to deal with it, although they may not like it. Here's who can't deal with it. Someone who's trying to start a business out of the spare bedroom of their home. The worker that desperately wants to be an owner. The employee that wants to take out their life savings and open up a business. They can't do all that. They're the ones that get crushed by big government because they can't afford to figure it out and they can't afford to deal with it. And so it is a lie to say that big government helps the people that are trying to make it. It doesn't. There is only one recipe to protect and grow and make more secure the great American middle class, and that's free enterprise and limited government. And I'll tell you, and let me tell you why that's important. It's not just important in terms of prosperity. It's not just important in terms of prosperity. This existence of a vibrant middle class goes to the core of our identity. You know, know, every country in the world has rich people. And unfortunately, every country in the world has poor people. But only a handful of places have a middle class in the history of the world. Only a handful of places can people work at a job that pays their bills and provides for their family and opens doors for their children to do all the things they themselves could not. And that goes to the core of who we are as a nation and as a people. And it inspires the world. All over this planet, other people and other nations look to the example of America as an inspiration of what can be possible for them. The American example is the single greatest contribution that America has ever made to the world. It has inspired people to dream for themselves and for their nations a better future. And many have. All over this planet, there are millions of people who are emerging from poverty and into the middle class, not because they've embraced socialism, not because they've embraced communism, not because they've embraced collectivism, not because they've embraced big government, but because they've embraced the principles of free enterprise that America paved the way for. Nations are striving to be more like we have been. Why would we ever want to try to be more like the way they have been? And yet those are the ideas that this president promotes. Because there have always been voices in American politics that do not understand and do not believe in the American free enterprise system. But that's what we're fighting for in this election. And it goes to the core of our identity. To me, this is deeply personal. As Ron just pointed out a moment ago, everything that I look at is colored through the eyes of my upbringing. That's true for all of us. Who among us is not influenced by the way we were raised and what we saw growing up? So I shared this at the convention, and I want to share with you how I grew up. My parents came to this country, like so many have before, in search of a better life. My dad never made it big. My parents were never rich. My dad was a bartender. He worked at hotels. My mom was a cashier. She was a maid at a hotel. She was a stock clerk at Kmart. My parents worked jobs. And with those jobs, they were able to provide for us a home where we never had everything we wanted, but we always had everything we needed. The most important thing they were able to give us is a strong and stable home where we were always loved and we were always encouraged to dream big dreams. I always knew growing up that because I was an American, there was nothing I could not strive for. There were no limits to my future. Have these jobs? Because someone who had access to money decided that instead of leaving it in the bank or putting it under their mattress or buying bars of gold somewhere and stashing it in a safe, someone decided they were going to risk the money. They were going to take the money they had made, and instead of leaving it stashed away, they were going to invest it in a new business because they believed that it would work. It was a risk. There's no guarantee, but it worked. And because it worked, my parents had jobs that allowed them to provide for us the home that I grew up in. And because countless Americans across this country had enough money left over in their pocket after they paid their bills to take vacations to Miami Beach or to Las Vegas, where I grew up in those two cities, my parents had jobs in the tourism sector. And so you come to understand that this economic growth and prosperity that we all desire is not that complicated. What it requires is people with the confidence to take money they have access to and invest it in starting a new business. Yep. And when it works, it creates jobs and opportunities for others, who in turn create, spend that money and create jobs and opportunities for others. That's how the American enterprise system works. And what we need are more leaders in government that understand what government can do to encourage that. Like a normal tax code. Yeah. Like regulations that are the process of a cost-benefit analysis. Yeah. Like a pro-American energy policy that will lead to a renaissance in manufacturing. Like a government that doesn't spend so much money that it has no idea how it will ever pay it back. And we need those kinds of elected officials at every level of government. You have someone running for Senate right here in this state and all across this country, that we have the opportunity to win these races and change the direction of our country for the better. We need more Scott Walkers. We need more Ron Johnsons. And we need Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan. That is what this election is about. It's about electing people that don't just understand this, that believe this, and will do something about this, and will set an example for leaders all across this country to follow this path, because if they do, there is something I'm going to tell you that I know to be true at the bottom of my heart. If they do, if we do a few simple but important things, the 21st century will be the most prosperous time in the history of this nation. Our children. Our children and our grandchildren have the opportunity to be the safest and most prosperous Americans that have ever lived. We are just a handful of important decisions away from ushering in the new American century. And all it takes is for us to go out and do our job. Get Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan elected, and it starts with you, Wisconsin. And so I came here today from Florida. I came here today from Florida. Well, truth be told, I came here from Missouri. Because I understand how important the state has become. This state, it's not an exaggeration to say that this state can decide the presidency of the United States. And deciding the presidency of the state of the United States will decide what this country looks like in the 21st century. You have a chance if you vote, if you get your neighbors and your friends to vote, if you do and continue to do what you are doing right now, to turn out the vote, work every minute that you have available between now and election day to get people out to vote. Then, on that night, 12 days away, we will have a chance to take the first step in accomplishing what we all want, which is to leave our children and our grandchildren what they deserve to inherit. A new American century, the single greatest nation that mankind has ever known. Thank you very much.